Welcome. In this class, we will talk about diversity in living organisms. Now, a very interesting thing about organisms and living organisms is there are nearly 15 lakh animal species, around 3 lakh plant species which survive on planet Earth. Now, understanding each of these species individually becomes a problem. To simplify that, what we do is to have a taxonomy. Taxonomy is a process through which we classify similar species under one group, similar genus under one group, and this is how we simplify the whole process of classification. In very simple words, I can say we as an organism and cockroach belong to a same family of animals, and this is under the animalia classification of the plant kingdom. But do we have a very similarity between the circulatory system, the nervous system that exists in a cockroach versus a human being? Definitely no. So how do we classify it? To make it simpler is this simple classification. Now, each of these categories of this taxonomy chart is known as taxon. The lowest one is the species. Now, species are group of individuals which have a capability to breed among themselves, and therefore they have a interdependence within themselves. This is called as the basic unit of classification under the taxonomic classification. Next to species is the genus. Genus is where closely related species come together. For example, crow, we talk about a specific species of house crow, for example. But under genus, we would talk about house crow as well as jungle crow. Both of them are crow, but they have different traits. One is a kind of crow which could be seen in the domestic areas. However, the other is seen in wild areas. And therefore, both of them would fall under the genus, a common genus. But independently, their species would be two different species as house crow versus a jungle crow. Next to the genus is family. Under the family, we have a genus which have common characteristics. Now, when I say common characteristics, a very simple example to explain this is lion and tiger. Lion and tiger, both of them belong to Panthera. That's the same family. So that's the same genus. And then we also have cats which belong to Phyllid, which is the same genus. But together they are in the same family. So lion, tiger and cat, all of them would fall under the same family. I repeat again, tiger and lion under the same genus, which is Panthera, and then cat, which is under Felis. Both of them would fall under the same family, which is Felidae. So the family here remains the same for tiger, cat and lion. So that would be a family classification. The next stage would be the order. Now, order would be a much higher version. I can say carnivora is an order. So tigers, wolves, lions, all of them which are carnivorous would fall under one category, and this would be called as order. All mammals would fall under the next category, and this would be the class. Now, all the mammals would fall under chordates, which is the phylum. These chordates would fall under the kingdom, which is the animalia. And finally, the domain, which is eukaryoid. Now, under the five kingdom classification, we talk about Monera, Protista, Fungi, Plantae and Animalia. Now, among these, Monera is the prokaryoid. So, the domain is just two. One is eukarya, the other is prokarya. So, the domain here is eukarya. Now, under the eukaryotes, we have four, which is protist, fungi, plants and animals. So, of those four, we are talking about one, which is the animal kingdom. Then, under the kingdom, we have the chordate and the non-chordate classification. So, that comes under the phylum. Now, under the chordate classification, we have five. Aves, pisces, amphibia, aves, reptiles and mammals. So mammals is one of the class. So mammalia becomes a class here. So this is how we classify and further subclassify. The highest one is called as domain, followed by kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, and species. Species is the lowest unit of classification. Now coming on to the five kingdom classification. The five kingdom classification which was given was proposed by Whittaker. Whittaker's five kingdom classification is very, very important, and this is based on the cell structure. So to come with, the first one is, as I already mentioned, Monera, Protista, Fungi, Plantae, and Animalia. Monera is the one which is belonging to prokaryotes. Protista, Fungi, Plantae, and Animalia are eukaryotes. Now among these, Monera and Protista, two of those are unicellular. The remaining three, Fungi, Plantae, and Animalia, are multicellular. So another important difference. Under Monera, we talk about bacteria, blue-green algae. They don't have well-defined nucleus, they don't have cell organelles, they can be autotrophic or heterotrophic, that means they can prepare their own food or depend on others for their food supply. The next is Protista. As I mentioned, they are unicellular, but they are eukaryote, that means they have well-organized nucleus and various cell organelles. They may have cilia, flagella, and pseudopodia. Protozoa and algae are good examples, and these, when they are animal-like, they are heterotrophs. When they behave as plant-like, they are autotrophs. So, in the case of algae, it would be autotrophs. In the case of protozoa, it would be heterotrophs. Coming on next is fungi. Now, fungi is a non-green multicellular organism which is saprophyte, and they have a cell wall. Now very important to note is the difference between the cell wall of a fungi and the plant. Plants also have a cell wall which is made of cellulose. However, the cell wall of fungi is made of chitin. Very, very important difference. You must remember it. All the saprophytes, all the fungi are saprophytes except one and are multicellular, except one which is yeast, which is unicellular. So yeast is unicellular, except that all fungi are multicellular. All of them are saprophytes. They have a cell wall which is made of chitin, and they have threads which are called as hyphae. They also have the base which is united, which is called as stolon. Some of the common examples of fungi are yeast, rhizopus, mucor. So these are common fungi that we see. Then coming on to the Plantae kingdom, they are multicellular, green, have a capability to produce their own food. The cell wall is made up of cellulose. They are autotrophs since they can produce their own food. The next is Animalia, which is again multicellular. Since they belong to animal kingdom, they do not have cell wall. The very basic difference that we have understood in our chapter on cell, the difference is the plants have a cell wall, animals don't have a cell wall. So cell wall is absent. They are heterotrophic. They do not produce their own food. They depend on the Plantae kingdom for their basic food requirements. And also animal kingdom, one very important characteristic is limited growth. Once they attain maturity, the growth stops. That is not true with the plant kingdom. So this is the basic five kingdom classification. Now today, what we would go is dive into further depth of the plant kingdom and the animal kingdom classification. The three basic classifications of Monera, Protista, and Fungi are done. Under Fungi, one very important thing that we need to understand is the cell wall. I repeat again, it is made of chitin. The cell wall of plant cell is made of cellulose. Commonly asked question, very basic information you must be familiar with. Under Protista, one very good example is Euglena. And for the Monera, we already said bacteria, blue-green algae are common examples. Coming on to the plant classification. Plant classification, we classify them as cryptogame and phanerogame. Crypto plus game. Crypto means hidden, game means marriage in Latin. That means we call this as hidden marriage. Phanerogame means, phanero means visible, game means marriage. So again, visible marriage. That's the Latin synonym, or the Latin meaning we could say for these words. Now cryptogams are those which do not produce seeds. So three under these, Thallophyta, Bryophyta, and Pteridophyta, and then under Phanerogams, which are seed bearing. Since they are seed bearing, they are also known as spermatophyta. These are gymnosperms and angiosperms. Let's understand each of these one by one. So to understand first cryptogams, they do not produce seed, no true stem, root or leaves, vascular system is seen. They produce solely by spores. Thallophyta is the first one. Thallophyta includes algae. They are the most primitive one. They are not differentiated. They synthesize their own food. They are autotrophic in nature and can be present in fresh water or marine water. Algae commonly are green algae, brown algae and red algae. Green algae, Spirogyra is a common example. Ulthrix is another common example. Brown algae, Laminaria is a common example. And red algae, Nemelonia is a good example. Under Bryophyta, which is the next classification under Cryptogam, we have three important ones. Mosses, liverworts and hornworts. Mosses, sphengum is a good example. Liverwort, Rickettsia is a good example. Hornwort, Nothotylus, is a good example. So all of these three, in all of these categories, we are talking about few examples. There are many more, but just to have an overview, be familiar with few of the names. So Bryophyta classified under mosses, liverwort, and hornwort. The basic thing is they are the first terrestrial plants which are present in shady, damp areas. They are also called as amphibians. They are called as amphibians of the world because they have a capability to grow in a damp area. They require water for fertilization and the xylem phloem is absent in this case. They do not have proper roots, proper flowers which are seen in Bryophyta. The next is Pteridophyta. Pteridophyta are called as the first true vascular plant. Since they are called as first true vascular plants, that means xylem and phloem are identifiable. Roots, stems and leaves are identifiable. Ferns are a classic example to explain pteridophytes. Under ferns, there are azolla as a good example. Then besides ferns, also club moss and horsetails. Club moss and horsetail are example for Pteridophyta. Coming on next is Phanerogams. Phanerogams, as we said, are seed bearing. Gymnosperm and angiosperm are the two classification. Under gymnosperm, conifers and cycads are the good example. Conifers, pine, fir plant are those which fall under conifers. Cycads, cycas is a common example that we understand. Here, the seeds are exposed and that's a major thing that differentiated from angiosperm. So under gymnosperm, the seeds are exposed. They are mainly woody seed bearing plants, we can say. They do not have flowers and the male and the female reproductive organs are separate. The female reproductive organs are the cones. There is no fruit. Again important, under angiosperm, we classify it as monocot and dicot. Dicot, which can be broken into two cotyledons, which we can see. So good examples would be pulses. Any pulse that you take, commonly common pulses that we talk about is P. You open the outer layer of the P and then you try to open it, you would see it bifurcates into two. However, cereals, commonly wheat, maize, you have just one piece, it cannot be broken into two equal halves. So we call it as monocots versus dicots. A very simple classification based on the number of cotyledons that are present. Another important thing is angiosperms are food bearing. They do have fruit and ovary develops into the fruit and ovules develop into the seed. So that's again very important for angiosperms. So this was a quick classification for plant kingdom to understand the very fundamentals of each of the classifications. Coming on to animal classification. Animal classifications, we broadly classify it as chordata and non-chordata. Non-caudatas are less evolved and they do not have a notochord. Caudata are those which have a notochord at some stage of development and they do have the gill cells. They also have the nerve cord, which is one, and it is hollow. So the caudates have a nerve cord which is single and it is hollow. However, under non-caudate, the nerve cord is double and solid. Again, hemoglobin is present in RBC in the case of caudata. However, in the case of non-caudata, the hemoglobin is dissolved in the plasma. There is no post-anal tail which is present in non-caudata, but caudata, like we do have a post-anal tail. However, it is rudimentary in human beings. Heart is present on the dorsal side in the case of non-caudata and on the ventral side in the case of caudata. Again, a very important difference. In contrast to this, nerve cord is vice versa. So nerve cord is present on the ventral side in the case of non-caudata and on the dorsal side in the case of caudata. So that difference must be remembered, extremely important. Under caudata, internal skeleton is present. However, that internal skeleton is absent in the case of non-caudata. So sponges do not have an internal skeleton. So non-caudate, a good way to understand is remember the example of sponge. However, caudata do have an internal skeleton. Human being you can keep as a good example here. Now, animal kingdom, as we understand, can be classified into caudata and non-caudata. Under caudata, or what we call as vertebrates, we have five classification, which is pisces, amphibia, reptilia, aves and mammalia, which is a relatively easier section. We'll do it towards the later side. Non-caudata can be classified into porifera at a cellular level, at a tissue level, and then at a broad organ level under coelom and acoelom. So under acoelom, which do not have body cavity, platyhelminthes and nematode are good examples. And those who have a body cavity includes annelid, arthropoda, mollusk and echinodermata. So all of these, porifera, cnidaria, platyhelminthes, nematode, annelid, arthropoda, mollusk and echinodermata, 8 of those would be understood under non-caudata and 5 of those we would understand under caudata. So let's first understand these 8 non-caudata first. The first one is porifera. Porifera are pore-bearing organisms. They are sessile, fixed, and they have sponges, right? A good example for porifera is sponges. The skeleton is made of spilicules or spongin fiber. The body has pores. These pores are known as ostia. I repeat again, the invertebrate or the non-caudata have 8 classification and caudata have 5 classification, right? So ostia are the body pores which are present in porifera. Porifera are sponges, sessile, fixed, and they appear similar to plants, but they are actually not plants. They appear similar to the plants. Now, what happens in the case of porifera? The water enters the hollow space, which is known as spongocoel, and then comes out from osculum. This is the process through which the respiration takes place, incoming of the food and oxygen takes place, and carbon dioxide and excretory products are removed through it. So the canal, the central canal, the central body we could say is called as spongocoel, and the exit through which it comes out is known as osculum. The next, cnidaria, are also called as coelenterates. They are also called as blind sac body plan. Okay, so blind sac body plan or coelenterates, also called as cnidaria, have radial symmetry. Radial symmetry means if I cut them from any angle, they would have a similar body. They have two layered body, which has a gastrovascular cavity, which is enclosed, and ectoderm and endoderm are separated by mesoglia. So mesoglia is the layer that separates the ectoderm as well as the endoderm. One very interesting phenomena about sealant treat is the food is ingested and egested from the same opening. So ingestion and egestion takes place from the same common opening. They live in seawater. Hydra is one which lives in freshwater. So commonly seen in seawater, Hydra is one which is seen in freshwater. So the example of sealant reed, we know now Hydra. That is a common example you can remember. They also have stinging cells which are known as nematoblasts or cynoblasts. So that is the classification for Cnidaria group. Another important thing is under the sealant reeds, we do have another interesting example which is corals. So corals would also fall under the category of Cnidaria or sealant reed, and they can be colonial, that means they appear in group and they are sedentary in nature. That is another important aspect that we need to understand here. Coming on to the next classification, which is acelomate, we have platyhelminthesis and nematode. Platyhelminthesis, flatworms, a common word that you can remember here. Nematodes or nemehelminthesis, the common word is roundworm. So flatworm and roundworm, I would use these terms for simplicity. So coming on to flatworms, they are triploblastic, they are parasitic, bilaterally symmetrical. I cut them from the center. They are not radially symmetrical like Cnidaria, but they are bilaterally symmetrical. Very, very important. Flat, ribbon shaped. They do not have body cavity. They attach to the host and act as suckers. So flatworms attach into the small intestine of human beings and suck the blood, and therefore they are without body cavity, without circulatory system, without a respiratory system, because they depend on others by all means. Very important thing under flatworm is F for flat, F for flame. So their excretory organ is known as flame cell. So a good way to remember is flatworm, flame cells. Examples under flatworm, planaria is a good example. Planaria is free living. Fasciola or liver fluke is the one which is present in the animals. Similarly, in human beings, liver fluke is present in sheep and other domesticated animals. In human beings, blood fluke is present, which is seen in human blood. Tapeworm in intestine is another example for the same. Roundworms, also called as important as nematodes or nematohelminthesis. We'll use a commonly used term, which is roundworm. Again, they are bilaterally symmetrical. They are pseudocoelomate. They have a false coelom. They do not have an actual body cavity, but it appears that they do have a body cavity. So they could be classified either under acelomate or pseudocoelomate classification. They are free living or parasitic in nature. The body is cylindrical, and the circulatory system, respiratory system again is not present in roundworms. So till acelomate, pseudocoelomate, there is no respiratory system, no circulatory system which is present. They are seen as parasites. So roundworm is a common parasite in human intestine. Ascariasis is the disease which it causes, which we have covered in our separate classes on human health and hygiene. So you can refer about ascariasis more there. They also are responsible for numerous other diseases. Some of those affect the intestine, the GI system of animals as well as human beings. The next important classification that we proceed with is the coelom classification. So far we talked about acelomate. Now coming on to coelomates. Under coelomates, Annelida, Echinodermata, Arthropoda and Mollusca are the four important classification. Annelid are segmented worms. Segmented means their body do show segments. They have long cylindrical soft body which has rings. These rings are called as annuli. Annuli are the rings which are present on the segmented body of the annelid. They have a true body cavity, and therefore they are called as coelomate. Each segment has bristles or the chitin layer, and this helps in movement or locomotion. This chitin layer is called as setae. For each segment which is present, excretory organs are long, coiled, and they are called as nephridia. Excretory organs in the case of platyhelminthes were called as flame cells. Here they are called as nephridia. The names are important. Do remember. Okay. Here the excretory system, circulatory system are well developed. Respiration occurs either by skin or gills. Examples of annelid, earthworm, farmer's friend, leech, and then Neris is a good example. Arthropoda is the next classification. Arthropodas are animals with jointed leg. They have bilateral symmetry, coelom, which is a cavity, body cavity, which is present. The body is divided into three parts, head, thorax, and abdomen. The common classification with usually six pairs of three pairs of legs, which are seen, total six legs. Okay. Now, respiratory organs could be gills, trachea, and one very important thing is presence of antenna. Now, this antenna act as tactile receptor. They touch and sense. The other is compound eyes, which are present, and they act as photoreceptor. They are sensitive to the light. Insects usually fall under arthropoda, and the study of insects is known as entomology. So, entomology is the branch which studies insects. So that is for arthropoda. The next is mollusca. Mollusca have a soft and unsegmented body. They do have a hard shell. So their body, which is the mantle, is soft, and then you have a hard shell which is present. This shell is made of calcium, so we call it as a calcareous shell, and again it is triploblastic, bilaterally symmetrical, and is coelomate, so it does has a coelom or a cavity. Body is divided into head, foot, and visceral mass. Now the classification is important. For arthropoda, it was head, thorax, and abdomen. For mollusca, it is head, foot, and visceral mass. So foot is the ventral side, and this is responsible for creeping and burrowing. Then the next is the blood. The color of the blood for mollusk is blue. It is called as hemocyanin. Hemocyanin, cyanin, the word denotes blue color. Okay. So hemocyanin, blue blood, is seen in the case of mollusks. Again, a very important thing that you must remember. Mainly mollusks are aquatic in nature. Few of them could be found in the garden area as garden slug, but most of them are aquatic in nature, and they could be freshwater or they could be marine water. The next is echinodermata. Echinodermata is radially symmetrical. So far we were talking about bilateral symmetry. So bilateral symmetry was seen in annelid. It was seen in arthropoda. It was seen in tapeworms, flatworms, and it was seen in roundworms. Then we talked about radial symmetry. Radial symmetry was seen in Sinetra, and then again in Echinodermata. So Echinodermata have radial symmetry, very, very important, triploblastic, and they are coelomate. They have a coelom or a cavity. Sea urchin, starfish are examples of Echinodermata. Now, Echinodermata, as the body shape is star-shaped, it is star-shaped in the case of starfish. It could be spherical or cylindrical in certain cases, for example sea urchin, and this is differentiated into two surfaces, oral and aboral surface. The animals falling in the classification of Echinodermata are usually seen in the sea bottom. So they are either attached to the bottom, either they crawl or they swim. But they are usually seen in the ocean bottoms or the sea bottoms. They do not have a head nor a tail. And they also don't have a right or left side. So again, few interesting facts about Echinodermata. They move through suckers, and those suckers are the ones that help them in locomotion. They attach to the substratum and then move forward. for the prey, for having capturing the prey. Now the classification of chordata. The simplest classification we can say is Pisces, Amphibia, Reptilia, Aves and Mammalia. So, five of those that we have classified, Pisces, Amphibia, Reptilia, Aves and Mammalia. So, that is the five simplest classification. But here what we have done is made this classification a little more elaborate. So, we classify chordate under urochordate, cephalochordate and then vertebrate. And then vertebrates divided under the five classification. Now, urochordates are urochordates, cephalochordates, both of them fall under what? They fall under protochordates. So we classify first chordata, then we understand protochordata. Chordata are what? They are the organisms, they have hollow tube nerve cord. As we understand, understood under the difference between the chordate and the non-chordate, chordata have a hollow nerve cord, however that is solid and double in the case of non-chordate. Here it is hollow and single. Notochord is present, which is replaced by the vertebral column, which is present in higher order organism. And then the gill slits are present at some stage of the life cycle. They may exist in the later stage or not. Okay, the next is the nerve cord, which is present throughout the life, and this notochord, as I said, is replaced by vertebral column. Gill cells are present only in the fishes, and they are either in some stages and then rudimentary. And then the tail behind the anal opening is present, and that is called as the postanal tail. The next is protochordata. Protochordata, we classify them as urochordata, cephalochordata or hemichordata. Hemichordata, Belengoglossus is a good example. Urochordata, Hermandria. Cephalochordata, Amphioxus. So these three species fall under protochordata. Now protochordata, the notochord is rudimentary and it is present in the larva stage only. It again, protochordatas are bilaterally symmetrical, triploblastic, unsegmented body is seen, but they have notochord as rudimentary. Clear? Coming on to the next is vertebrate. Vertebrate are those which have a well-developed vertebral column as they proceed with the adult stage, and this is where the notochord is present only in the embryo stage. Okay, so notochord in the vertebrates are present but in the embryo stage. As the organism grows into an adult organism, vertebral column is present and therefore the name vertebrate. So under the vertebrate classification, we have the Agnatha and the Gnathostomata, but under this we won't go into further details for this level. We would simply classify the five classifications under vertebrate, which is Pisces, Amphibia, Reptile, Aves and Mammalia. Now Mammalia, we'll start with the most complex ones and move towards the simplest, towards the Pisces. So Mammalia are the most higher order organisms under vertebrate. They are warm blooded animals. They have sweat glands, oil glands. Both of the glands are present, the sebaceous glands as well as sweat glands, external ear, mammary glands, four-chambered heart. Platypus and echidna are exceptions, which are oviparous, but otherwise mammalia are viviparous. And some mammalia, for example kangaroo, gives birth to poorly developed young ones, so they have to take care for a longer period of time. The next is aves, which is birds. They are highly evolved and they have a perfect aerial mode. So they are evolved for the aerial purpose. Feathers are present all over the body. The forelimbs are transformed into the wings. The back limbs, the hind limbs are actually transformed into the legs. So the transformation of the wings and the legs for the aves is seen. The body is kept warm with the help of feathers, and beak is present for the taking the food. So that's another important characteristic. Four-chambered heart is present, and they are egg-laying animals. Now, the egg of the eaves or the birds are large. They do have yolk and a shell. So, these are three important characteristics that you must remember about it. And then, eaves have a good capability to migrate. Migratory birds, as we commonly hear, are those birds which travel from one location to another. And that is one of the reasons to adjust to the climatic changes present in the given atmosphere. The next is reptilia. Reptilia are the first true terrestrial vertebrates which are seen. And then after the reptilia, there is an evolution towards mammalia. So reptilias are the first one. They are cold blooded. They cannot adapt themselves to the they are cold blooded. Okay. So they have a capability to adapt themselves. The next is the body classification for reptilia. They have neck, head, neck, trunk and tail. So four classification: neck, head, neck, trunk and tail. And then they have two pairs of limb and they have pentadactyle toes. That means five toes, and each of the toe would have a horny claw, and that is to protect itself and to find the food. Also, the skin is dry and scaly. Respiration occurs by lungs. Heart has two auricles and two ventricles. Again, the eggs are large, yolked and shelled as eaves. So similar thing that we have understood here. Under reptilia, the common things that we hear are snakes, lizards, tortoise. They have dry scaly skin, lungs for respiration, and they do also have a extra embryonic membrane that protects them in water. So that is during the developmental stage. The next is amphibia. Amphibia are again cold blooded animals. They have a capability to live both on land and water. The body is divided into head, trunk and tail. Very important, neck is absent. Neck was present in reptiles. Neck is absent in amphibia. So amphibia, there is no neck which is present. Again, interesting phenomena. The front limbs have four toes. The back limbs have five toes. In contrast to reptilia, it was pentadactyle. There were five toes. Amphibia have four in the front, five in the back. So number of toes, four in the front, five in the back. They have nictitating membrane on their eyelids, that is to protect their eyes when they dive into water. Moisture glands are present. The skin is without scales. Scales are present in reptilia. And then amphibia, common examples would be frog, toad, salamander. The next and the last one in this classification and the last for this lecture as well is pisces. Pisces or fishes. Now, fishes are classified as bony fish and cartilaginous fishes. They are cold-blooded, aquatic. Amphibia have three-chambered heart. Pisces have two-chambered heart. They can be seen both in freshwater and marine water. Bony fishes are found both in freshwater and marine water. However, cartilaginous fishes are exclusively found in marine water. They have an endoskeleton. Cartilaginous fishes have an endoskeleton which is made up of cartilage. The tail is heteroceral, mouth is ventral, and operculum is absent in the case of cartilaginous fish. However, in a bony fish, the tail is homocerular, mouth is on the terminal side, not on the ventral side as in the case of cartilaginous fish, and the gill slits are covered by operculum. However, operculum is absent in the case of the cartilaginous fish. So again, some of the very, very important differences. Their skin is slimy, present with scales, and this is to accommodate or make it familiar with the water stream. Now, under the cartilaginous fish, good examples would be electric ray, stingray. Are examples for cartilaginous fish. Under bony fish, we have rohu, which is a good example. Then lion fish, mandarin fish are good examples for bony fishes. So those were some of the important classification that we have understood for the vertebrates here. In case if you have any questions or doubt, feel free to post those in the comment section. We'll be more than happy to resolve it, and wish you very good luck. Have a wonderful day ahead.